We're starting. Thank God. Okay, let's begin. I'm grateful because it's always good to record these things so that in case you have any doubt, you can rewind and you can listen to it again and clarify those things. And if you have any doubts, any questions, please send them to me through WhatsApp and I can answer it in the next session. Okay. And if there is a break in the voice, in the continuity, and you feel that something just went over your ears and you couldn't hear it, please let me know by intimating me on the message. Say, Pastor, kindly repeat the last sentence that you said so I can repeat it for you. Okay, so don't feel that you're interfering with my thing. We're a family. We're discussing something from the Bible and we must have a proper environment, a proper, you know, interaction so that we can, you know, do these things in a nice and helpful way. So I want you to feel free that if you suppose you don't understand something, please ask me to repeat and I will repeat it for you. But please don't raise questions in between. Questions should be written down and sent to me by WhatsApp so I can answer it after the message is over or when we have another session for answering questions. Okay. Now, let's go to the plan of salvation simplified. Now, the reason I'm saying plan of salvation simplified is because I want to tear out the difficulties, complications, uneasiness, and the non-confidence in the way that God works. People are not able to place their faith on a sure, thus saith the Lord. They're not able to place their finger on this verse and say, this is why I live. This is why I'm going to be saved. This is how God saves me. So people are in a turmoil. People are confused with their own theology. So we need to, and I'm not blaming anyone for this. Please don't take me that, oh, I'm coming here as some big person trying to condemn. No, that's not the point. I just want to make things more simple so that we can see and find out where we've missed out and what we need to apply more particularly into our lives and not overlook certain important things which can cost our salvation. Okay. Now, as we enter into it, maybe have another word of prayer. Kindly bow down with me wherever you are. Let's have a word of prayer. Our loving, living Heavenly Father, I thank Thee, Lord, for this blessed opportunity that we as Thy children, as one family, even though we are placed so far away in different parts of the world, we're able to unite in this Zoom meeting to be able to speak about the wonders of salvation, the wonders of the Lord Jesus Christ, and what He is doing, what He has done and is doing for us in the heavenly sanctuary. Thank the Lord for Thy mercies. Thank the Lord for hearing our prayers. We submit ourselves just as we are. Take us and give us the lessons that we need to learn through Thy Holy Spirit. For I ask all these blessings in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.
Now, as we go through this study, I want you to be prayerful, if possible, so that your attention will not be diverted or distracted. Make it a habit to just take down notes. So as you take down notes, what happens is your mind will be focused on what is being spoken. So you can take notes and even write down any question that comes to your mind so you can address it later. Sometimes your question may be answered in the process of the message. Sometimes you may need, if it is not answered, you can always, throw them at me so I can give the answers to you at a later period of time. All right. So now, as we go through salvation, we need to go to the simplest part of the Bible, which is creation. You know, sometimes people think it is more easy to believe in evolution, which is taught in our schools and colleges, than to study about creation. They say, oh, you know, studying the Bible about creation is so difficult. But evolution, you know, it's evolution science. Science is more easy for me. I can use formulas and I can understand, you know, this, that, and the other. But actually, my friends, evolution is a much more difficult thing to believe than God's creation. Because God's creation can be believed by faith. But in order for you to believe in evolution, you need to have something more than faith. And that is a lack of brains. That is what is the crucial junction at which we are standing. People are there ready to boast about science, falsely so called, Whereas the simple Bible and the gospel that is revealed there is something that is complicated to them. Of course, a small portion of that responsibility comes with our theologians who have taken the Bible and tore it piece by piece and put so many kinds of, you know, meanings and nouns and pronouns and different words and different settings and different history and all these things have confused people, no doubt. But God is not the author of confusion we hear in the Bible. God never is the author of confusion. God is a God of order. And so we will see what it is that happened in the beginning. You know, Adam and Eve were created by God, isn't it? Now, before we get into that creation part, let us just go get into this, let's place a foundation which we can build on. First thing is, because we're talking about salvation and what we lost in salvation, we have to go to the book of Genesis and read there in chapter 1 and verse 26. Genesis chapter 1 and verse 26. There we see that God created man, that is Adam and Eve, in his own image, in his own likeness. What is his image and what is his likeness? Image is how he looks, the appearance. We were made in the appearance of God. We appear like God in form. The image, our image looks like God. And likeness means his character. Remember when our babies are born and the baby behaves in a certain way and talks in a certain way or moves in a certain way or smiles in a certain way, what do we say? See, he smiles just like his grandfather, or he walks just like his mother, or he does this just like his father. Likeness means the likeness of character. Therefore, God created Adam and Eve in his image and in his character. So what is God's character? Now, God's character has to be studied, isn't it? So when we go to the book of Psalms, chapter 97 and verse 2, the Bible says, I'm reading Psalms 97 and verse 2. Clouds and darkness are round about him. Righteousness and judgment are the habitation of his throne. Oh, so the very foundation of God's throne, the very the stone upon which God's throne sits is righteousness and judgment. So now, because God's throne itself is placed on righteousness, it goes without saying that God's character also is righteous. A righteous God with a righteous character sits on a throne that is made of his righteousness, a throne in righteousness. Let's go on. The Bible says in Psalms 119 and verse 172, Psalms 119 verse 172, the Bible says all his commandments are righteousness. So not only is God righteous, not only is God's throne, which is the foundation of his kingdom, is righteousness, the Bible says that his commandments also are all righteousness. And we know that Jesus Christ is called Jesus Christ the righteous. We see that in 1 John chapter 2 and verse 1. Now, as we see all these things, we know that God created Adam and Eve in his own image, in his own likeness. And then when we go to Genesis chapter 2 and verse 25, Genesis chapter 2 and verse 25, the Bible says that Adam and Eve were naked, but they were not ashamed. In what sense were they naked? And if they were naked, why were they not ashamed? Oh, we can just say, oh yeah, because there was no sin, they were not ashamed because there was no sin. Kind of lords that we were. If God created them in his own image and in his own likeness, it is also understood that God gave them his own clothes to wear. That's quite logical, isn't it? Let's find out what was God clothed with. What are God's clothes? Let's go to Psalms 104 and verse 2. Bible is very, very simple. Psalms 104 and verse 2. The Bible says, who covereth thyself with light as with a garment, who stretchest out the heavens like a curtain. All right. So here we see that God covers himself with light as a garment. That means the garments of God were garments of light. Therefore, Adam and Eve were clothed with the garments of light. Now, if light was their covering, then obviously they were naked in the sense that they were not wearing clothes like you and me. I am a man, I wear a shirt and a pant. So I'm not naked. But Adam and Eve were naked in the sense they were not wearing clothes like you and me, tailored clothes, but they were wearing the robes of light, which was the garments of God, the clothes of God. That was God's clothing. God covers himself with light as with a garment. Now, if that was true, what happened after sin? Okay, let's look in Isaiah chapter 61 and verse 10. Isaiah chapter 61 and verse 10. The Bible says that God comes down to us and he does something. I'm reading from Isaiah 61 and verse 10. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God, for he hath clothed me with the garments of salvation. He hath covered me with the robe of righteousness. Let me read that verse once again. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God, for he hath clothed me with the garments of salvation. What are the garments of salvation? They are the robe of righteousness. He hath clothed me with the garments of salvation. He hath covered me with the robe of righteousness. So therefore, Adam and Eve were covered with the garment of salvation, which is the garment of light, which God wears. And he covers us with the robe of righteousness. So the garments of light are the robe of righteousness. And the robe of righteousness is the garment of light. And this is from God. It is not from Adam and Eve. If you remember, as soon as Adam and Eve sinned in chapter 3 of Genesis, we find that they suddenly wanted to cover themselves with fig leaf garment. Remember the first profession after gardening that Adam and Eve took on was tailoring. Just in passing, let me mention, do you think Satan is going to leave tailoring alone in these last days of world's history? He's going to use tailors and tailoring, or if I can use the word fashion designing, he's going to use this to corrupt morality among the human beings, among the human race. He's going to destroy the morality that God intended that you and I should have by making dresses in such weird kinds of fashion, and which people of the flesh of the world are going to lust after. And sadly, many Seventh-day Adventist young people and old people are following after the lust of fashion designing in clothes. And Adam and Eve began their first work after sin in fashion designing. And my friends, even after they wore the clothes of the fig leaf garments, they were not able to cover their nakedness. Isn't that what happens even today? The work of our own hands can never cover the shame and nakedness that comes because of guilt and sin. But only that garment of light which God can provide can protect us from the guilt of sin and the shame of betraying Christ. All right. Now, I want you to go a little more deeper and see what happened. You see, Adam and Eve fell into temptation. She caused Adam to sin also. And when they both sinned, they saw that they were naked without the light that God had clothed them with. Because as soon as we sin, what happens? Because I want you to notice this very importantly. This is the the mechanism that takes place when every person sins. As long as they did not sin, they were naked, but they were not ashamed. That is Genesis 2:25, the last verse of Genesis chapter 2. It says, Adam and Eve were naked, but they were not ashamed. Reason, they were covered with the robes of light, which are the robes of righteousness, which are the garments of salvation, which God had given them. By the way, it was not called robes of righteousness or garments of salvation before sin. These names were given after sin. That's the only difference. Okay. In heaven, there was no need of robe of righteousness to be covering because they were righteous in themselves. God placed the law, his law, in the hearts of Adam and Eve. So they naturally obey, love to obey God. They naturally love to hear God. They naturally loved to serve God. That was because they were born in God. They were born in Christ. They were created by Jesus. And they were covered, they were filled with his character, with filled with his righteousness. They were made like that. They were holy. They were a holy pair. There was no sin, not yet. But now, when that was the condition in Genesis 2:25, that Adam and Eve were covered with the garments of light, which came from God. Note that point. The garments of light was given to them by God. But as soon as they sinned, they lost this garment of light and they were covered in shame and nakedness. So therefore, they tried to cover themselves with fig leaf garments, but they still were not complete. They were empty. They had a lack. They were not satisfied or they were not fully covered and they still were guilty and they were still ashamed of themselves and they went and hid behind the tree when Jesus came looking for them. Now, with this in the point, we find that as we go to Genesis, let's see what happened in the third chapter. What was it that happened after they, after Jesus came looking for them? What did he do? I want you to see in verse 21, Genesis chapter 3 and verse 21. The Bible says, unto Adam also and to his wife, that is to Eve, did the Lord God make coats of skin and clothe them. God made clothes of skin and clothed them. And by the way, now here it does not say which skin was used to make those coats of skin for Adam and Eve. That is clarified in the Spirit of Prophecy, in Patriarchs and Prophets, in Spirit of Prophecy Volume 1, and also in the book Desire of Ages, we see that the coats of skin which was made by God for Adam and Eve were taken from the lamb that was slain in order for Adam and Eve to receive forgiveness from God. Right there, we see the establishment of the sanctuary service, the promise of a savior to come, the promise that man is not left to die in his sin, that God has had made an arrangement. He had made a covenant that man will not be left alone, that man is not doomed to eternal death, that God has brought in a way, God has intervened and has symbolically slain a lamb. And as we know in the sanctuary service, who was it that killed the first lamb? We know in the book of Leviticus, chapter 6, chapter 5, if you read those two chapters, you can see everyone who committed a sin has to bring a lamb and that he himself, the sinner, was to kill the lamb. The sinner was to kill the lamb. Therefore, symbolizing that by every sin that was committed, they were killing, they were the cause for the death of the Redeemer who was promised to come. You see, so every lamb that was slain was to be slain by the sinner. So since Adam and Eve were the sinners, it goes without saying, it is the unquoted statement that Adam killed the first lamb and Eve killed the second one because they had to confess their sins upon the head of the lamb, which pointed forward to the coming of Jesus to come and die for them on the cross of Calvary. That is where the sanctuary service began, right outside the gates of Eden. Right outside the gates of Eden. So you find, my friends, now God gave them a sheep's skin to be a lamb's skin to be a covering for Adam and Eve. Why couldn't God make a garment with his power, divine power. Make them a cloth like we have these modern tailors. Zap! And you could just get a beautiful, long, beautiful overcoat in different colors, like Joseph's coat of 12 colors or something like that, and covered Adam and Eve. Why did God have to make them kill lamb? The reason is very plain, my friends, because the lamb pointed forward to Jesus Christ. It was a symbol of the Lamb of God, which would take away the sin of the world, according to John chapter 1, verse 29. Now, if that is true, then Adam and Eve saw in the future with prophetic eyes. They were able to see that it was because of their sins that Jesus was going to come and die for them. Now, if Jesus was going to come and die for them, it is only by his death and by the shedding of his blood that they could get forgiveness of sin. And once they were forgiven of their sins, they would be covered not with the fig leaf garments of man's self-righteousness or his own righteousness, which comes by his deeds, by his works or whatever, but they would be covered by the lamb's skin. The lamb's skin is the clothing of the lamb, which God has given to it naturally. But when the robes of the lamb are nothing but the robes of righteousness of Jesus Christ, which is the lamb. So now, as we read in Isaiah chapter 61 and verse 10, that God has clothed me with the garments of salvation and with the robes of righteousness. As we saw these phrases, it means that Jesus Christ symbolically clothes us with his robes of righteousness when we confess our sins and ask him to forgive us. But as soon as we ask for pardon, and we believe that Christ is willing to pardon us and forgive us of the sins that we have committed, and we believe that Christ has really indeed forgiven us, then we raise up from our knees covered with the lamb's coat, not our own clothes of our own suits or our own garments of humanity, our own garments of selfishness, our own garments of pride, our own garments of boastfulness, our own garments of all the good works that we've done, but we are clothed with Christ's righteousness. Because only that can save us. We see that in the Garden of Eden. Adam and Eve were not clothed with any garments that they were able to make, but they had to be clothed with the garments that God made them. It was God's garment that was given to them. They lost one, which was the garments of light. And now God himself gave his, symbolically, his garments of righteousness, which is the skin of the lamb. Therefore, when you just translate that to our present time, if at all you and I need to be saved, we are saved purely by having the imputed righteousness of Jesus. Imputed simply means given or put upon. Okay? Imputed righteousness of Jesus Christ, which comes to us not by doing some great penance, not by doing some great deed of charity, but simply by claiming the promise of Christ, which he says in 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That's a simple promise, but it is full of power. When we claim that promise and say, Lord, because thou hast said in thy mercy that by thy grace my sins are forgiven, not because I am worthy, but because of Jesus who loved me and gave himself for me, I believe that I am forgiven. And as soon as you believe that you are forgiven, your sins are removed from your heart, cleansed by the blood of Jesus, and he clothes us with the garments of his salvation, garments of his righteousness. His righteousness, mind you, his righteousness, not our righteousness, because that is the only righteousness which God the Father is going to recognize when we go back to heaven by the grace of God. Now, as we go on, we understand that these things are so simple, it is hard to believe. Is that all we have to do? Confess our sins and ask God forgiveness? Everything is over? But there are many things attached to it many things come with knowledge. Duty follows knowledge. You have more knowledge we have about the plan of salvation, the more accountable we are to what we do with our life, what we do with that knowledge. Therefore, let us see what God is going to show us. Now, God says, as we saw, let's look at Isaiah chapter 48 and verse 18. Isaiah chapter 48 and verse 18. Let's see what the Bible says over there. Isaiah chapter 48 and verse 18. All right. The Bible says, "Oh, that thou hadst hearkened to my commandments, then had thy peace been as a river and thy righteousness as the waves of the sea." Now, the Lord says, "Oh, that thou hadst hearkened to my commandments." When we listen to God's command, that means when we obey God's commandments, then our peace will be like the river and our righteousness as the ways of, see, we are doing, who is it that gives us righteousness? Who is it that gives us righteousness? Can we earn righteousness by our own ability or by our own, righteousness or by our own efforts? No, we cannot. So it comes from God. How do we receive it? By faith. Now, if that is true, now look at this. We saw that the garments of sin, the garments of light were lost in the Garden of Eden because of sin. And God replaced that garment with the garments of skin, and he did that. Now, I also told you that in Leviticus chapter 5 and chapter 6, verse 1 to 7, you can see that God says, in order to receive forgiveness, a lamb has to be slain. Without shedding of blood, there is no redemption. Hebrews 9:22. We know that. Now, if all these things are in place, let us look at one more aspect. It says here that in Zechariah chapter 3, verse 1 to 7. Let's go to Zechariah chapter 3 and verse 1 to 7. Zechariah chapter 3, verse 1 to 7. Zechariah chapter 3, verse 1 to 7. Here is a remarkable event that is portrayed in the Bible. It talks about Joshua, the high priest. Now, Joshua, the high priest, represents not only Christ, but also us. It represents, because we are the priests of God, isn't it? We are a royal priesthood. Do you remember that? 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. Who are we? We are those who are called out of darkness into his marvelous light, isn't it? We are priests of God. Okay, we are the royal priesthood, the Bible says. Therefore, Joshua, the high priest, is representing us before God in the judgment, before the angel of the Lord, that is Jesus, and Satan standing at his right hand to resist him. Let's look at verse 2. "And the Lord said unto Satan, the Lord rebuke thee, O Satan, even the Lord that hath chosen Jerusalem rebuke thee. Is not this a brand plucked out of the fire?" Now, Joshua is being condemned by Satan by all the sins he has committed. This is the judgment scene, okay? And Satan is bringing all the records of sin that Joshua may have committed to point it out and say that Joshua was his, that Joshua belongs to Satan and not to Jesus. But the Lord says in the scene, he says, "The Lord rebuke thee, O Satan, even the Lord that has chosen Jerusalem rebuke thee. Is not this a brand plucked out of the fire?" That means Jesus is saying, is not Joshua a brand that is plucked out of the fire? That means plucked out of all the difficulties and sorrows and temptations he had to face, life experiences that he had to face, the persecution, the ridicule, the sin, the guilt and the shame that he had to experience. He's a brand that is plucked out of the fire. Now, Joshua was clothed with filthy garments and stood before the angel. You see, in the judgment, none of us can go and stand before God when we confess our sins. We have to confess that we are filthy. Our garments are filthy. That garments means what? Our characters. Our characters are filthy. Remember, I'm just telling you these things. Make a note of it. Garments are representative of characters. It's a symbol of character. So if your garment is filthy, your character is filthy. If your garments are pure, then your character is pure. The garments of Christ are light, and light is pure. Therefore, God is pure. God is holy. God is righteous. Okay. Now, that is why God wants to impart to us, impute to us his character, so that we can stand before God without guilt, without shame. So Joshua was clothed. I'm reading verse 3 of chapter 3 of Zechariah. Now Joshua was clothed with filthy garments and stood before the angel. And he answered and spake unto those that stood before him, saying, take away the filthy garments. You see, when Jesus is there telling the angel and saying, angel, take away the filthy garments from him. And unto him he said, behold, I have caused thine iniquity to pass away, pass from thee. So what is the symbolism of removing that filthy garment? Christ says, now Joshua is in a position of confessing his sin. He is guilty. He doesn't excuse himself. He doesn't say, Lord, I did this because of this circumstance. I wouldn't have said that if my wife wasn't like this. I wouldn't have done this if my boss didn't say this. I wouldn't have done this if so and so. You know, we are not giving excuses. Like Adam gave excuse for his sin. He said, Lord, that woman who you gave me, she gave me and I ate. And the woman said, Lord, that serpent. You know, there was no blaming somebody. So here it says, so Joshua came there filled with all his guilt, with filthy garments, and he stands before Jesus. And God the Father is the judge, and Jesus is our advocate. Satan is our accuser of the brethren, and all the angels are witnesses. So Joshua standing there full of guilt, and of course he has confessed his sin, and the confession is acceptable to God. And so Jesus gives the command, take away the filthy garments. So the meaning of taking away the filthy garments is in the next half of that of verse 4. It says, behold, I'm reading that. What's the meaning of taking away the filthy garments? The second half of verse 4 tells it. Behold, I have caused thine iniquity to pass from thee, and I will clothe thee with change of raiment. Oh, my friends. Wasn't that the same thing which happened to Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden? God had to give them a change of garment, a change of raiment. Adam and Eve were covered with the sinfulness of their garments of fig leaves. But Christ said, that cannot save you from nakedness. You are naked before God because you have sinned against him. You have lost the character which God wanted you to possess. Therefore, you stand before him filthy, guilty of the sins which you have committed. Now, because you confess your sins sincerely and earnestly, and because you are willing to forsake them, I will give you a change of raiment, a change of garment. And that is, I will take away your filthy garments and put on you my garments of righteousness, my garments of perfect obedience to the law of God. Jesus Christ, the righteous. 1 John chapter 2, verse 1. The Bible says, little children, I tell you that no one should commit sin, but if he sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. I want you to notice where I'm emphasizing. Jesus Christ, the righteous. He is the only person who ever lived a righteous life on this earth. Because the Bible says, there is no one righteous, no, not one. So, not one person has ever lived a sinless life in this earth. Yes, many were taken to heaven. Enoch, he offered sacrifice for himself and for his family. Moses, yes, he was taken to heaven. Elijah, yes, but Elijah offered sacrifice. He asked pardon for his sin. Moses asked pardon for his sin. Enoch also asked pardon for his sin. But they perfected Christian characters. They believed in the righteousness of Christ and lived a life which God could approve, and therefore they were taken alive and as well as without seeing death. So we see that Elijah, Enoch, and Moses are a type of those whom God will save from sin and from the depths of death. Okay, now let's go forward. Then he says, there's a condition that is placed. We'll talk about that a little later. Okay, now let's come back to what you were talking about. Now you saw the beauty of the plan of salvation. How does this happen? How does this happen? Let's look at Isaiah chapter 64 and verse 6. Why do we need a change of garment? We need to understand that, isn't it? Isaiah 64 and verse 6. Isaiah 64 and verse 6. The Bible says very clearly, Isaiah 64 and verse 6, the Bible says, but we are all as an unclean thing. All our righteousnesses are as filthy rags, and we all do fade as a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, have taken us away. Let me read that again. But we are all as an unclean thing, and all our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. Let's look at Isaiah 57 and verse 12 again. Let's see the repetition of that same verse. Let's see how it is written in Isaiah 57 and verse 12. Look, it says here, I will declare thy righteousness and thy works, for they shall not profit thee. I will declare thy righteousness and thy works, for they shall not profit thee. Using both these Bible texts, we come to a beautiful conclusion. And that says, no matter what kind of good things we have done, no matter how purely or how strictly we have obeyed God's commandments, that will not benefit me. Unless it is mixed or mingled with the righteousness of Jesus Christ. We will expand on that as we study. Okay? Expand on that as we study. Now, as we go forward, brother, I think my time goes up to 8 p.m. I'm sorry, that is up to 3 p.m. Your time, just give me a little thing so I can just know how far I'm going. Okay, I don't get a response. Let's continue. Let's continue. Okay, the Bible says all righteousness are as filthy rags. Now, let's look at Ezekiel chapter 33 and verse 12. Let us see how desperately we are in need of the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Okay, let us see how desperately we are in need of the righteousness of Jesus Christ, without which we, no one, none of us can be saved. Ezekiel 33 and verse 12. The Bible says, therefore, thou son of man, say unto the children of thy people, the righteousness of the righteous shall not deliver him in the day of his transgression. As for the wickedness of the wicked, he shall not fall thereby in the day that he turneth from his wickedness. Neither shall the righteous be able to live for his righteousness in the day that he sinneth. That means, no matter how perfectly we may have lived in the past, one sin can turn everything upside down. One sin can turn everything upside down. That one sin, you cannot quote your past righteousness and say, Lord, because I've been faithful all these days, please allow me to enter heaven with one sin. No, that even that one sin has to be confessed and forsaken, without which we cannot be saved. Okay, let's keep that in our minds and let's go forward. Now it says, Romans 3 and verse 23. The Bible says, why is it so bad that we cannot be saved without Christ's righteousness? Because according to Romans 3:23, the Bible says, all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The glory here, of course, represents or symbolizes God's righteousness, his character. We have all come short of the character of God, which God wants us to possess if we want to be the members of God's family in heaven. All right. Now, keeping this in mind, let's go a little more forward and see what God says, how dependent we are on God's mercy. Titus chapter 3. Verse 5 to 7. Titus chapter 3, verse 5 to 7. Let's look at this beautiful verse. Titus, just before Hebrews. Okay? Titus chapter 3, verse 5 to 7. Now, not by works of righteousness which we have done, But according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost, which he shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Savior, that being justified by his grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. What is the meaning of justified by faith? Pardoned by his grace. Justified by his grace, we should become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. The Bible says very clearly that we are so dependent on the righteousness of Jesus Christ. It says, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he said, his mercy, he saved us. Not by our deeds, but by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. How does this happen? How does this act of grace take place? Let's go forward. Please keep these verses noted, write them down. And when you have any questions, please write those questions also down, because you'll forget them. When doubts and questions come, that means the Holy Spirit is working in your brain. It's working in your heart. And so you have to respond to it. Don't be unresponsive. All right. Then the Bible says in Jeremiah chapter 23 and verse 6. Jeremiah chapter 23 and verse 6. Let's see what the Bible says in Jeremiah chapter 23 and verse 6. The Bible says, in his days, Judah shall be saved, and Israel shall dwell safely. And this is his name, whereby he shall be called the Lord, our righteousness. Can you see, my friends? Israel is going to be saved. Judah also is going to be saved. But how will Israel and Judah be called? Now you can translate that and transpostulate that and put it, apply that thing to ourselves. We are the modern Judah and the modern Israel. Now, how will we be saved? How will we be saved? The Bible says, we shall be called the Lord our righteousness, not our own righteousness. You see, we are not saved by our righteousness. We are saved by the Lord's righteousness. The Lord our righteousness. He is our righteousness, not anything that we do. All right. Let's go to 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 8. The Bible says that Jesus Christ is the righteous judge. Jesus Christ is the only one who is righteous, that we already saw in 1 John chapter 2 and verse 1. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, 8, the Bible says that Jesus Christ is our righteous judge, that we are going to receive the crown of life from our righteous judge. He's going to give it to us at the time of rewards. Now, if that is true, we have to do something in order to work with God, to cooperate with God. What is it that God wants from us in order for him to save us? What is it that God, is it some big thing? Is it something so terrible, so costly? Is it something that is, you know, undefinable? Something that is superhuman? Is something that has to work with penance and something that is so terribly difficult for us to do in order to gain eternal life? Let's see what God says. Let's go to Proverbs chapter 28 and verse 13. Proverbs chapter 28 and verse 13. The Bible is very, very simple, my friends. The Bible is simple. We need to take it simple. That is where we fail. We complicate the Bible unnecessarily. The Bible says in Proverbs 28 and verse 13, he that covereth his sins shall not prosper, but whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy. Look at the condition. He that covereth his sins shall not prosper. The covering here, can any one of us cover our sins from God? Let's look at Job 31 and verse 33. The book of Job, chapter 31 and verse 33. The book of Job, chapter 31 and verse 33. Job 31 and verse 33. Just hold on. Yes, I'm almost there. Job chapter 31 and verse 33. The Bible says, if I covered my transgressions as Adam by hiding my iniquity in my bosom. What is the meaning over there? Do you understand what the meaning was? The meaning of covering is not hiding from God anything that we do, because God sees everything and we are nakedly exposed before God. We can't hide from God. Doesn't the psalmist say, Lord, even though I climb up to the heavens, thou art there. If I go to the depths, thou art there. If I go as far as the east, thou art there. I cannot escape from thee. True, my friends, God sees us inside out. We can't escape from God after having committed sin. God sees everything with open eyes. It's like an X-ray vision. We can't hide anything from God. So if that is true, then what is the meaning of the word that we saw here in Proverbs 28 and verse 13, where it says, he that covereth his sin shall not prosper. What does it mean? That means he who tries to excuse his sin, like Adam tried, is what it means to covering up your sin. If we try to cover up our sins by excuses, with excuses, as I mentioned to you earlier, Lord, if it was not for that young man, I would not have become angry. If it was not for this situation, I would not have told a lie. If it was not for this, I would not have cheated. If it was not for this, I wouldn't have thought that. All these excuses, God says, I don't want. God simply says, acknowledge your sins before God. Acknowledge your sins. That is where many of us fail. We try to escape from God by offering excuses. We try to cover our sins. That's what the Bible says. He that covereth his sins shall not prosper, but whosoever confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy. So what is it that we need to do? First thing is, no excuses for your sin. Yes, Lord, I lied. Yes, Lord, I thought evil. Yes, Lord, I got angry. Yes, Lord, I used bad words. Yes, Lord, I cheated. Yes, Lord, I did this, I did. Don't try to escape from your sin. Accept your sin. Let's go to the book of Jeremiah and let's see how God tells us to deal with our sins. How he wants us to deal with our sins. Jeremiah chapter 3 and verse 13. Chapter 3 and verse 13. Jeremiah. Let's go to Jeremiah chapter 3 and verse 13. The Bible says, only acknowledge thine iniquity. Only acknowledge thine iniquity, that thou hast transgressed against the Lord thy God. That's all. I'll just stop there. Only acknowledge thine iniquity, that thou hast transgressed against the Lord thy God. Whatever sin we may commit against our fellow brothers and sisters is a sin against God. Don't think sinning against God is calling him bad names or cursing Jesus or telling something that is blasphemous or worshipping idols, or only that is sin against God. But what I do against my neighbor, evil thinking, you know, vulgarity, cursing, bad words, evil imaginations, lustful thinking, adulterous thinking, all these kind of things are also sin against the Lord. A false signature, false dealing with money, misusing money. Yes, many times we think that there is no sin against God when we use 9/10 of the money that we earn for our luxury and for our worldliness. Yeah, we think, yes, God told me 1/10, I give 1/10, that's right, that's all. God shouldn't ask me anything more. No, God holds you responsible for the 9/10 that you use also. He tells you, that is the money I've given you. 1/10 is for me. He takes it if you give it willingly. God doesn't like offerings that come with drudgery. God wants you to give it willingly and cheerfully. God loveth a cheerful giver, the Bible says. Yes, true. But the remaining 9/10 is not for us to use as we want. We can use it for necessary things, for godly things, but we must also remember that we cannot throw money around and waste it on our luxuries when we see so many people suffering and dying around us. And what we do is, oh, when we see some elderly person, we don't want to help them, we don't want to feed them, we don't want to give them some clothes, we don't want to help them, give them a place to sleep, because we say, oh, no, that the old age home is there to take care of that. The orphanages are there to take care of the orphan children. Well, we can't. Oh, for me, two children is enough. I have my hands full with just two children. And why should I take another child from the streets? God doesn't say that, my friends. That's not how God thinks. God says we must open our homes for the shelterless, for the homeless, for the parentless. We should not depend on the worldly charitable societies which do these kind of things. They may do their things nevertheless, but God will hold us responsible when we don't do what we can do from our side to help the downtrodden, to feed the hungry, to clothe the naked, to give shelter to those who are without. Oh, now you may think, oh, what, Pastor, what are you saying? It's impossible. Yeah, if you have those kind of things, write it down and keep it, and we can discuss that later. I'll tell you more clearly how God wants us to do. All you have to do is read one simple book called as Adventist Home. Just read that book. And you will see how God is going to hold us responsible for not doing what we should do for our neighbors around our homes. Anyway, I just want you to understand the fact that sin is not what we generally think it is. Sin is everything that is displeasing to God. Everything. Pride, selfishness, arrogance, fighting, quarreling, cheating, lying, stealing. Everything is sin in the sight of God. Adultery, sexual immorality, immoral dress, immoral words, all these things are sin. Even our diet, when we eat those things which harms our physical structure, our bodies, even that is sin. Many of us think, oh, that's not a big salvation. No. It is a very, very crucial point. We'll discuss that later. It will come as we study the subject of righteousness by faith or salvation simplified. Okay. Now God says, we must not cover us. That means, as we saw in Jeremiah chapter 3, verse 13, he says, only acknowledge your sins that you have transgressed. Don't hide your sins. Don't excuse your sins. Don't give excuses for your sins. Don't say, if only that was there, I wouldn't have done this. No. God says, if you have sinned, however small it may be, however big it may be, God says, confess it. But there's a condition. You must confess it with the intention of not repeating it. That is where many of us fail. We must confess our sins with the clear indication, with the clear intention that we will never repeat it again. That's why when we come to God with confession, we must say, Lord, I'm sorry for getting upset with my wife, or sorry for making me upset with my children. Sorry for making for me, because sorry, forgive me for being impatient with my staff, with my workers. Suppose there are doctors. Doctors can sometimes be very impatient and speak fretful words, angry words to their nurses. So doctors need to talk to them, you know, ask God and say, Lord, forgive me for being rude to my nurse or to my secretary or to my wife or husband or children to their parents. Tell that and tell, Lord, by thy grace, help me never to be rude again. Help me never to be angry again. Help me never to be adulterous again. Help me never to be licentious again, pernicious again. Help me never to tell a lie again. I am weak, Lord. I am sinful, Lord. And the power of habit is controlling me, Lord. By thy grace, keep me from falling into that same temptation. Keep me from sinning. I trust that you can do this, Lord. Take it away. I hate my sin. I hate that sin, that action, which caused grief to my Lord and which caused him to shed his blood on the cross of Calvary for me. So therefore, Lord, forgive me. And I pray, I promise you, Lord, by the grace of Christ, I will not do it again. Only that kind of prayer is answered by the Lord. Now you may say, oh, Charles, what are you saying? This is too much, man. What is this? Then who can go to heaven? Because our confessions are done more out of fear of going to hell, burning in hellfire, than a change of character. Loving to obey God. It is not coming out of love, out of that we want to obey God lovingly and cheerfully. It comes because, oh, I cannot go to heaven because I've sinned. So Lord, please forgive me. I want to be there. We must not confess out of fear. I'll give you two verses which the where the Lord himself tells you that. Let's go to the book of Psalms and let's read in chapter 66. Psalms 66 and let's read verse 18. Psalm 66 and verse 18. Yeah, the Bible says, I'm reading Psalms 66 and verse 18. The Bible says, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. If you have any regard for iniquity, if you have cherished a sin, a wrong word, a wrong dress, a wrong diet, a wrong food, you love it so much, you're not willing to give it up, but you simply say, Lord, forgive me for my sins and shortcomings and end your prayer. Your prayer is not heard. You are not forgiven. Therefore, you will not have the power to overcome that sin which you have committed. Are you following me? I pray you are following me. Now, let's read one more verse. The Bible says, if I regard iniquity, that means if you have regard for iniquity in your heart, you don't tell it by word, you don't tell it by action too, but in the secret of your heart, in the depths of your heart, if you have a regard for a particular sinful activity, a sinful thought, a sinful habit, a sinful, surpassing or a bypassing of God's command, a sinful indulgence, whatever it may be, secretly watching something. Many of us have mobile phones. Who knows what we are watching on the mobile phone, how we are using the mobile phone? Parents give their children mobile phones. How do you trace or you track down what your children are doing with those mobile phones? Do they know how to use a mobile phone? Or when they go with their friends, who knows what their classmates, their friends and their colleagues or whoever it may be, what they are telling them and showing them on those phones which have internet access. When they come home, they may not show any signs of these things. And the children demand so much of privacy from their own parents. So they say, Mommy, don't touch my phone. Daddy, don't touch my phone. And all these things happen. And parents are on an edge. They don't know what to do. They can only say, please, please, children, don't join with these people. Don't get misled. Don't be led astray. No, this is bad. This is bad. We just tell them that and we hope. Against hope. We hope against hope, hoping that our children will not fall into some trap. But most of the time, our children are living double or triple lives at the same time. At home, they live one kind, pleasing daddy and mommy. When they go to their college or to their school, they live according to their friends' expectations. They talk like them, they live like them, they do mischief like them, they watch things like them because they have to be in the trend. They have to be trendy. They have to be in the group, in the groove, they say. You see, now that is one terrible temptation for them. And then the third thing is when they go to church, they are the third lifestyle comes there. In church, hello, Pastor. Happy Sabbath, Pastor. How wonderful to the Sabbath is. Yeah, you don't even know what's happening in the other two parts of their life. In the home life and the school life is absolutely different from the church life. In church, the pastor says, oh, what lovely children. At home, father, mother, oh, what a lovely child. How sincere they are. How earnestly they're studying. How nicely they're doing these things. What a lovely child we have. In school, yeah, bro, that's how it is. Come on, let's do it. A different lifestyle. My friends, we have to stop pretending that we are good in all these areas. We have to stop having a regard for any kind of iniquity that is necessary. Because if you have those regards, God says, I will not hear you. God says, I will not hear you. Let's go to Psalms chapter 5 and verse 12. Just to make this a little more clear. Psalms chapter 5 and verse 12. The book of Psalms chapter 5 and verse 12. The Bible says, for thou, Lord, will bless the righteous. With favor will thou compass him as with a shield. You see, God will bless the righteous or the person who wants to be righteous. But the Lord cannot bless those who have regard for iniquity. That's why the Bible says the Lord will not hear your prayer because you still have a regard for iniquity in your heart. And the next verse that I want you to come to is found in Proverbs chapter 28 and verse 9. Proverbs 28 and verse 9. Here the Bible says, he that turneth away his ear from hearing the law, even his prayer shall be an abomination. Shall be, as you see, if you read in the KJV, you'll see that it is an added word. Shall be is not in the original. It just says, even his prayer, abomination. He that turneth away his ear from hearing the law, even his prayer shall be abomination. Oh, my friends, did you understand that text? It is so, so crucial. Many of us have the problem or the disease, I call it a disease of selective hearing. Do you understand that? Selective hearing. We like to hear only what we want to hear. We will not hear all the wisdom and all the counsel of God. We want, if somebody says something about jewelry, no. I don't want to hear about that. No. My God is not that kind of a God. Anyone talks about diet, if someone talks about ice creams, that's not my kind of God. I don't want to hear that. That's nonsense. That's ridiculous. No. If somebody talks about chicken or somebody talks about beef or somebody talks about steak, what's wrong with a steak? So what happens is we are selective in our hearing. We like to hear only what is pleasing to us and we hate anything that disturbs our peace, disturbs our comfort zone, anything that disturbs our lifestyle, we don't want to hear. So God says, any person who turneth away his ear from hearing the law, hearing all that the law says, even his prayer shall be abomination. Isn't that terrible? Keep that in your minds. We have not come to the end of this issue. Before we close today evening study, we have to finish two more verses. The Bible says we have to acknowledge our iniquity. And let's look at this. We need to confess with the intention of forsaking that sin. Okay, that's the thing I made, isn't it? We have to confess with the intention of forsaking that sin, not repeating it again. That's very, very important. Sometimes we have the habit, especially those in responsible positions, we have the habit of what I call as diplomatic lies. We use diplomacy, diplomatic words to avoid certain embarrassments, to avoid certain situations. We use what we call as diplomatic lies. Suppose we were late to office and the boss is going to be very upset with you. So we go planned with an excuse, which is not true. Oh, you need, sir. Actually, the cause would be we got up late, we delayed, and because of that, of course, if there are genuine reasons, that's a different story. I'm just talking about generally what happens. Not that this is exactly the only way it happens. No, it's not like that. Generally, these things happen. So what we do is we prepare. Okay, I'll manage somehow. You're already late at home. When you take your car out, you're already late. You're not going to reach late in the office. So you go there preparing a story to tell to your boss. And as soon as you go there, you make the story sound so real, the boss falls for it. And he says, okay, next time be on time. And you think, oh, great, I made it. I cheated the boss and, you know, call us up. But you know what? You have made Jesus ashamed. Jesus is weeping for you at the throne of God in the heavenly sanctuary. Angels bow down in shame because a child of God spoke a diplomatic lie to escape from an embarrassment. Would anybody go and say, sir, I'm so sorry. Even though I kept the alarm, I got up late today. And because of that, I came late to the office. Will you dare to say that? If you said that, hats off. I would appreciate it. But very few, many of us don't want to face it. Our pride and so-called self-respect is more important than Jesus and salvation. That is how we fail. Now, God says something else. Let's see. When we confess our sins, God says he will do what? Let's go back to that verse again. Can someone read that? He that covereth his sins shall not prosper, but he that confesseth and forsaketh them shall obtain what? Mercy. How will we obtain mercy? He that confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy. Now, what is that mercy? How will that? What does God do? Look at Isaiah chapter 55 and verse 7. A beautiful text, a beautiful verse which speaks about the loving kindness of our great and loving Heavenly Father. Isaiah 55 verse 7. Isaiah 55 and verse 7. Okay. 55 and verse 7. Let me read it. Let the wicked forsake his way. You see, God doesn't say let the wicked confess his sins. What did he say? Let the wicked forsake his way. And forsaking comes after confessing. Let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Even your thoughts has to be forsaken. And let him return to the Lord. And he will have mercy upon him and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. Oh, my friends, what a lovely Savior. What a wonderful God. What a sin-pardoning Savior we have. What more do we need, my friends? He is waiting for us, knocking at the door of our hearts. If we will open that door and let him come in, he will sup with us and we with him. He will be our heavenly guest. He loves to be in our hearts. He loves to guide us. He loves to give us victory over sin. He loves us to live above sin, above all this trouble in the world. He wants us to be victorious. He wants us to be joyful, bubbling, lovely Christians, showing to the world what a man can be in and through Jesus Christ. What a precious Savior. What a lovely Savior. Praise the Lord. God is mighty to save. And let's look at another verse. Now, how should we mention our sins? How should we mention our sins? We must mention our sins by name. Leviticus chapter 5 and verse 5. Leviticus chapter 5 and verse 5. A very crucial point for us to understand, and many of us might not understand the secret of the joy of receiving the pardon for our sins because we don't do this. Leviticus chapter 5 and verse 5. The Bible says, and pardon me. Lights have gone, so let's see. The Bible says, Isaiah chapter 5 and verse 5. And it shall be, when he shall be guilty in one of these things, that he shall confess that he had sinned in that. The word thing here, thing and things, is added. All right. So it says, and it shall be when he shall be guilty in one of these, that he shall confess that he had sinned in that. That means God says you must ask forgiveness for your sins by name. Of course, when we repent for our sins from childhood and we accept the Lord in our teenage or maybe in our middle age or maybe in our old age, when we come to Jesus, when we know salvation, when we earn or when we come to Jesus just as we are, it is all right for us to confess all our sins in one big bundle and say, Lord, forgive me for my sinful life, for my past sins, every one of them. And forgive me, Lord, cleanse me from all unrighteousness. And God is able to wipe the slate clean and give us grace. And by his grace, he's able to wash away every sin that we may have committed. In just one slash, he can do that. But after we have known what is sin, after we have known what is sin, it doesn't happen that way. Okay? How do we say that? Go with me to the book of Acts. Acts chapter 17, Acts chapter 17, and let me read to you from verse 30. Yeah, 30. The Bible says, Acts 17 and verse 30. And the times of this ignorance God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent. You see, God says in the times of ignorance, God just winked. He just didn't consider anything as sin. Because you're ignorant. All your past sins that you did in ignorance, all those things, God says, he just winks at it. Oh, I don't know. That's okay. Fine. You see, when our little children, they do some things which cause so much of damage, do we punish them? Do we get angry with them, upset with them, and beat them? No. If at all somebody tries to do that, what do we say? Don't be so foolish. He's only a child. He does not know. You should have kept your watch in a much more safer place. Why do you want to scold the child when you have done wrong in keeping such a costly thing in that place? Excuse me. Okay. So the Bible says, so in the times of ignorance, God winks at, but the times of when we have known what is right, once we have accepted the Lord Jesus as our personal Savior, and we know the commandments of God, we know what sin is, then, my friends, God says, you must confess your sins by name. Lord, forgive me for being angry. Forgive me for speaking a bad word. Forgive me for thinking evil in my heart. Forgive me for cheating. Forgive me for falsifying. Forgive me for jealousy. Forgive me for competing with my fellow student or something, anything like that. Forgive me for anything, for cheating, whatever it may be. We must ask those forgiveness for sin by name. And only then God will look into your heart and say whether you're really willing to give up that particular sin. And the very saying in our prayers and saying, Lord, forgive me for lying. I choose not to lie again. By thy grace, keep my tongue from lying. Keep my mouth from telling lies. Keep my mouth from speaking bad words. I cannot do it by myself, Lord, but I depend on thy strength, and I'm sure that Jesus can keep me, because thou hast promised in the book of Jude, verse 24, that thou art able to keep me from falling and to present me faultless before thy throne with exceeding joy. Lord, I claim that promise. Therefore, forgive me. Then your prayer is heard and your sins are forgiven. But when we pray just in one, Lord, forgive all my sins and shortcomings. Lord, forgive all my sins. And of course, I'm talking about these things only in our personal prayers, where we have to call sin by its right name. You can't do these things publicly. In public meetings, it is right to say, Lord, forgive us of all our sins and wash us by thy precious blood. Cleanse us and make us white as wool. We can pray like that in public prayers, in church gatherings. When we worship in the church together, these kind of prayers are good. But what I'm saying is, because salvation is not attending church. You see what I mean? Salvation is not attending church. Salvation is not keeping Sabbath. Salvation is saved by grace through faith, not of works, lest any man should boast. So the salvation that we receive from Jesus Christ is by faith through grace, or by grace through faith. That's what the Bible says. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. Verse 10 says, not of works let any man should boast, but we are his workmanship, that we should show forth the glory of God by our works. Now, we'll be touching these things in the next class as we understand where faith and works go together, how we are saved, and how God's righteousness is imputed to us. We'll talk about these things when we try to understand what it means to how to apply these things into our lives by faith, how to claim the promises of God by faith, how to live by faith day by day, one day at a time, how to walk with Jesus daily. You know, in the song Walking with Jesus, walking every day, walking all the way, we will know what that meaning is, how to walk with Jesus daily. So my friends, I want to close this day's message over here and stop it at this time, leaving you with a hunger, I pray, a hunger for knowing more. What else should I do in order to be saved? Was, as far as we spoke now, wasn't it very simple? There was no complication. Everything was there just as the Bible said it. No complications, no Hebrew and Greek, nothing. Just plain Bible. Simple. Just what God showed Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. What Adam and Eve lost, what Jesus wants to give us in order for us to get back to heaven. Very simple, isn't it? Salvation. The principles of salvation. The plan of salvation. Simplified. If we know this, my friends, it will make life so much more burdenless, so much more joyful, so much more full and free. And we will understand what it means to live by faith, what it means to be a glowing, bubbling, joyful Christian in this world. Today, most of the Christians who show their lives to be bubbly and joyful are the ones who love to sin and who are free to sin, who have no restrictions, no sacrifice. They can do what they want, eat what they want, watch what they want, speak what they want. Oh, just go to Jesus, do a cross and be saved. You know, that false religion is what many people are thinking they're happy. And we think that they're all very happy. No, my friends, that's very superficial. They're not happy. They're trying to make themselves happy by doing these things. That's the real crux of the matter. People are trying to show themselves to be happy when deep down they know they're lacking something. When you see a person who is overtly trying to boast about his wealth, about his fun, or about his party, or about his dancing, or his semi-nude dresses, and all these kind of things, when you can know that that person is terribly lonely. That person is terribly insecure. He does not know where he is headed. He is wandering without an anchor, tossed about in the waves, like in the wilderness, without a compass to show him the direction. That person is troubled. He needs the peace of Jesus. He needs the peace of forgiven sins. He needs the peace of the assurance of eternal life. My friends, don't be deceived by what you see. You need to understand what God is, what Jesus is for you in this life right now, at this very moment. It is not for any one of us to imagine things that are not written in the Bible and get, you know, swept away with a kind of feeling. Feelings don't save us, my friends. Feelings are not reality. Feelings will change with circumstance. So don't trust your feelings. If you feel good, do it. If you feel bad, don't do it. No, that's not right. However you feel, if God says don't tell lies, you don't tell lies whether you feel like it or whether you don't feel like it. You do good whether you feel like it or you don't feel like it. God says do good. If you don't tell lies, you must speak the truth. So you speak the truth whether you like it or not. Whether it's going to bring shame to you or not, whatever it may be, speak the truth. That's how plain salvation is. That's how simple it is. Shall we end here with a short word of prayer? Our loving, living Heavenly Father, I thank Thee, Lord, for the joy of salvation. I thank Thee, Lord, for giving us these inspired words to know how God works in our life and to know what we need to do in response to His gracious love. Lord, we thank Thee that we have a loving Savior who's waiting at the door of our hearts, knocking for entrance. Lord, may we have our hearts subdued, softened, and will willing to be made willing to open the door and let him in, that he may come and cleanse all the filthiness from us. Give us a change of raiment, a change of garment, that we may put off our filthy garments and be clothed with the garments of Christ's righteousness, without which we cannot see God or we cannot be saved. Lord, thank thee for thy goodness. Thank thee for thy help. Thank thee for thy precious word. We submit all that we are and all that we should be into your hands. Forgive us because of Jesus and accept us through his beloved name. For I ask all these blessings in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.